So there's an open world survival game called Saurian, where you play as a dinosaur in the Hell Creek formation. And if you go to one of the edges of the map, you'll see a pretty large sea. And if you go out into that sea, your dinosaur will eventually get eaten by a Mosasaur. The makers of the game specifically call this animal Mosasaurus hoffmanni, which doesn't have a lot of direct evidence of having been in the Hell Creek formation. In fact, up until this new paper, there's been no evidence for any Mosasaurus in the Hell Creek formation. But this new paper does help to suggest that this game may at least be partially right. And I say partially because they can't necessarily tell that it is Mosasaurus hoffmanni, although it is a possible option for what it could be. Meaning that, yes, there were Mosasaurs swimming around in the same environments as animals like Tyrannosaurus rex, Triceratops, and Odontosaurus, some of the most famous dinosaurs that there were. The thing with the Hell Creek formation, though, is that it's mostly terrestrial sediments, meaning that all of these sediments, or at least most of them, were deposited on land. It would have been a very swampy, kind of flat, forested plain. And that's very different than the actual specific member that we do find this Mosasaurus fossil in. But what we need to understand is that formations are essentially just units of rock that are mostly the same depositional environment. And then those are broken down into members where there's more subtle changes. So if we look at the Grand Canyon, which has a lot of different formations of rock, and zoom in on, say, just the Kaibab limestone at the top of it, you'll see that there's the Fossil Mountain member lower, and then the Harrisburg member above that. But these are still fairly similar environments, because they're both limestone-bearing rocks, meaning that it was probably just a reef system. Some formations, though, have a lot more variability in the different members, and the Hell Creek is one of these, and that's because they have the Brian member. The Brian member is actually marine settings, and so you might be wondering how we can tell actually the Brian member from the lower Fox Hill formation, because the Fox Hill formation is also marine. So what essentially distinguishes these two different formations? And so for that, we need to understand how the Fox Hill formation was formed. And it was deposited along the coast and near the coasts of a very large inland sea that cut all the way through North America. And so as that sea started to recede, some of these more swamp-like coastal conditions, like we see in the Hell Creek formation, eventually moved to the same place where the sea originally was. But once the Hell Creek formation starts to form, the sea didn't actually recede entirely. It was still there for a large part of the late Cretaceous. So the Brian member is the last push of this inland sea onto land due to just a local sea level rise. And the reason we define it as part of the Hell Creek formation and not part of the Fox Hill formation is because there are terrestrial sediments in between the two. You can actually see some of this in the diagram of the different sedimentology that's occurring in the location that this Mosasaur was found. And that's because you get these alternating bands of sandstones and mudstones, which is something more typical of a fluvial environment, meaning just it's a stream bed probably. Additionally, you get a very dark red carbonate-bearing mudstone, and carbonate just means that it probably had calcite in it, so it'll kind of fizz up if you put acid on it. But that does help indicate that it was a terrestrial environment, because that means those sediments were exposed to the air where they could oxidize and react with oxygen in the atmosphere. So this is actually the same pattern of rocks that we do see wherever the Fox Hill Formation and the Hell Creek Formation touch. And then eventually above those first rocks of the Hell Creek Formation, you do get the Brian member, which is where this fossil was found. Now the Brian member isn't necessarily a massive member of the Hell Creek Formation, meaning that this local sea level rise may have just been a few thousand years or even a few hundred thousand years, which on a geological timescale is very, very minute. However, during that short period of time, at least one Mosasaur swam into the area, died, and became a fossil, which means there's potential for them to have been in other parts of the formation, although since those are more freshwater, these Mosasaurs just may not have been as adapted to the freshwater as other Mosasaurs were, because we do have solid evidence that at least some Mosasaurs went towards freshwater fairly regularly. So we can say with reasonable confidence that this Mosasaur was swimming in the oceans, and some of the reasons we can say this confidently are probably part of the reasons that it was found so partially, which I will get into how partial it was. These include things like marine shark teeth, which absolutely could have bitten and chewed on parts of this animal once it died and spread the bones around. Additionally, there were fossil shrimp burrows, and it might seem odd to say fossil shrimp burrows are part of why this massive animal is so broken up and spread around, but when they're burrowing, they could have very easily pushed bones back up to the surface where they'd be more likely to break down, or even just spread them around horizontally within the layer that was being deposited at the time. So overall, what this means is if there is more of this fossil Mosasaur, it's probably spread out over a pretty large distance, at least horizontally. And it was actually found near the top of a hill, but it's still kind of impractical to just rip off the top of an entire hill just to find a few fossils that may or may not be there. And on the subject of that hill and these fossils being found very close to the top of that hill, there's prairie grasses on that hill. And they had very long roots, some of which were actually growing through the bones that were found on this expedition. And so that helps to indicate that potentially we might just be wildly, wildly lucky that we do have the few number of bones that we do have. Essentially, they could have very easily been lost in another bit of time. And so the fact that we found them at all is just incredibly lucky. We're also fortunate that there is a very well-defined metric for measuring how complete different Mosasaur fossils are. And this has been essentially calculated mathematically with thousands of specimens. So we have very, very good math and methods for how to estimate how complete a Mosasaur fossil is. And there's a couple of different metrics. The first of which is just total completeness, right? Like, how complete is this animal out of all the bones it would have? And on that metric, it scores a 1 out of 36 because we do not have a lot. We have a handful of vertebra and part of a jawbone, which I will get into. The next metric deals with how many of the parts of the bones are actually identifiable to a species. And on that metric, it gets a 3 out of 9, so it's at least a little bit better than a 1 out of 36. But its best score still comes on the last one, which is an informal completeness metric, which essentially just gives 3 points if you have parts of the skull, gives 1 point if you have parts of the body, and 1 point if you have parts of the limbs. And since we have some vertebra and one part of the skull in that jawbone, it actually scores a 4 out of 5, so it does reasonably well on that specific metric. So depending on which metric you're looking at, you might get a better picture of what the overall animal would have been versus other metrics. And while it is pretty incomplete, there's one specific feature on that jawbone that's pretty interesting. So to start with, the bone is the pre-articular articular complex of the lower jaw. Pre-articular just means that it's the bone right in front of the articular bone. And the articular bone is the rearmost bone of the jaw. It's what articulates and moves with the upper jaw. And on that bone, there's the glenoid fossa, which is where a muscle attaches from the top to the lower jaws to help power the jaws. And just behind the glenoid fossa, the bone steeply sharpens. And this is something we actually do see in one species of Mosasaurus, specifically Mosasaurus hoffmanni. So this animal was either potentially Mosasaurus hoffmanni or something closely related. Again, though, it's very broken up, so it's hard to tell, and you don't want to make these kinds of judgments based on just a single feature. However, based on some of these features and the overall size of the animal that's been estimated based on the fossils we do have, what they have been able to say is that out of the overall family of Mosasauridae, it specifically probably belongs to the subfamily Mosasaurinae, which means it's closer to animals like globidens, which had very blunt teeth for crushing ammonites, or animals like Mosasaurus hoffmanni. And this is different than other animals that are also in Mosasauridae, but in a different subfamily, things like the tylosaurs. But there's broader implications still, because as I mentioned, this was during a time period where the sea was overall receding, and while it pushed a little bit for the Brienne member, it was still much reduced from the giant seaway that cut North America in half that it had been millions of years earlier. And there's been some debate as to how many animals could actually be supported in this smaller inland sea. And based on the fact that there's still very large mosasaurs there, it could probably support them pretty well. I mean, you need to think about the entire ecosystem that would have been there in order to support such a large animal. You would need plenty of filter feeders and small plankton in order to essentially build the basis of this food web, and then larger and larger predators up from there. So it's also very good evidence that there wasn't a kind of gradual die-off of the mosasaurs, at least around North America, before the main impact event at the end of the Cretaceous. Instead, what it suggests is that that impact event is what eventually killed off the mosasaurs.